but I cannot go to the next slide here. It does not work. Sorry, because I here would.
Excuse me. It's okay.
Okay, so here the gags are made. Okay, so I start with articles for teachers. Gerd, probably you remember that we visited you last year. That's too loud. Oh my God. I can speak more.
Try with without.
Okay.
Can you listen?
Yes, just say something so that we can judge.
Okay. So Gerd, when we visited you last year, you told us not only to do research, but also to write articles for teachers. We have to go to school because we are Mathematikdidaktiker. And then yesterday I asked Karin to send me the articles she made for teachers. I remembered that she has 3 or 2 articles, because I printed the articles. I will tell you about them here on the piano, and I wanted to add the articles, the 2 or 3 articles for teachers, and this is what she sent me. So there are a lot of articles for teachers, and Gerd, you see in the first article you also are co-author. And to remind you, ML is not machine learning, it's Mathematiklehren. And it's a journal for teachers, for mathematics teachers. And maybe machine learning could help us here to figure out, to predict the first author of the publications. And of course, you see in Regensburg, this is a one-woman show, because Karin is very much connected with the teachers in Bavaria. So then, go back to research. Here, yesterday you told us not to publish in Frontiers. You see, 5 out of 6 articles are in Frontiers. So you should have told us earlier, probably. But I identified here you also published with Frontiers. And these are the articles I put on the piano, because I only will give you a very, very short overview. If you're interested, you can look at it and I can send it to you by email. So because I want to do a short presentation, I need a heuristic how to skip some of the articles, and probably here a good heuristic would be this article many people of you know. Hofrage Martin Jörg Gigerenzer, it's not only from Regensburg, so I skip this first. And here the next heuristic is, Karin will tell us in a few moments about this very fascinating, fantastic new visualization, the frequency net, so I also can skip this one. And then I can start with this article. I will only give you a very, very short glance on it, because then afterwards you can ask, you can look it up, and of course we can send you the articles. So this is a first article. It's an empirical study on Bayesian inferences based on visualizations. And the participants were school students at age 16 until 18. And I show you the visualizations we gave in addition to the Bayesian typical formulation of an inference task. Though we have 2x2 tables and we have 3 diagrams, and you can both equip with percentages, with probabilities, or with natural frequencies. And so the results were, I just report you the design very shortly, every article, and then the result also very shortly, that the students, the school students, indeed they could solve the problems much easier when the visualizations were equipped with natural frequencies. So the effect between the two contexts of task I will not go into detail. And what is astoundingly here is not the high performance with the visualizations equipped with frequencies, but with probability. So very low performance, although these visualizations we teach in school and we add in school textbooks to give young school students insight into Bayesian reasoning, so they do not help very much, obviously. Okay, the next study is we focused on these visualizations, the 2x2 table and the tree diagram, also with frequencies and with probabilities. And now here's one extension, though we did not only ask for Bayesian inferences, but also for marginal and for conjoint probabilities or frequencies, because in school the Bayesian task is only a small part of probabilistic inference of probabilistic thinking. So students in school, they have to assess conjoint probabilities, marginal frequencies, and so on. And here we have only visualizations because it's an eye tracking study. So we just gave the visualizations and then we asked the marginal, conjoint, or conditional probability question or frequency question. And we had university students as participants. So here I just will give you a glance on some heat maps. So the interesting findings are that we could figure out, we could replicate all mistakes and we could explain all mistakes, and some new mistakes which previously looked like random mistakes we also could explain here. So if you are interested in it, it's a pretty interesting article I find, but it's very specialized and yeah, it's a combination with a method that increases in education of mathematics. Okay, then the next article, so Karin extended the Bayesian case to two Q's test cases, so you can add the sensitivity and the false alarm rate of a sonogram of a second medical test. And so here we compared the version where only the text was given, so two cues were provided, and with a version where you also can see in addition a tree diagram, and we compared it with you give only the tree diagram. So the three conditions were only the text with two sensitivities, two specificities, or you can see in addition the tree, or you can only see the tree. And of course, again, all three conditions in probability format and in frequency format, you can try to guess what will work best. And here we had medical students and we tried to make it as ecologically valid as possible. It's a collaboration with the Faculty of Medicine in University of Regensburg. As you can see, the text only is the worst performance, but it doesn't matter whether you give the text as a visualization, the tree diagram in addition, or whether you only give the text. So that does not make a great difference. And in study two, in the same article, we try to boost performance because it's very important for medical students also to grasp the cases with two medical tests, which is of course normal, not only to make one medical diagnosis, one medical test. And here we try to boost the performance from study one, from the complete tree diagram, and compared to the normal tree diagram, we compared the highlighted tree diagram, because for the Bayesian inference based on two cues, only two branches are relevant. And if only two branches are relevant, you also can prune the tree and only present the relevant branches. And here we have the three conditions: highlighted, pruned tree, or the complete tree, as you have seen before. You also can guess what works best, pruning or highlighting. So interestingly, highlighting works according to Rich Meyer, and the pruning the tree is just as good as to have the complete tree. And finally, the last article I will present, so then I will say something about a German article. But the last English article is from Patrick Weber, so it was advised by Karin Binder. And he asked in the McDowell meta-analysis, she figured out that 24% can solve Bayesian reasoning problems with natural frequencies. But why we have only 24%? Yesterday, Hans-Jörg Neh told us that the solution is already given. So that has to be explained. And here again, we only ask for Bayesian inferences. And we ask the people to write down the approach to their solution as detailed as possible. So we really wanted to figure out not only the number they give, but what they did. And we had 180 mathematically advanced university students, so it was not a sample on students of pure subject matter mathematics, but of economy and of students who should have some experience with mathematics. We implemented slightly modified versions to be open for working with all formats. So, and if you do this, you can see that if you give probabilities, we have two problems here, the heroin addiction problem on the left, the car accident problem at the right. If you give probabilities, most of them calculate with the probabilities, 87%, 78% in the other problem, in the other context. And indeed, there are about 10 until 20% of students who really applied natural frequencies, although probabilities are given. But what is much more astounding is that if you give frequencies, the better format, the much more easy format, then a great part of students, about 50% across both contexts, they just convert it back into probabilities in order no longer to be able to solve the task. So, and the reasons, it's very interesting, we can speculate, because for some students, obviously, it does not seem sound to use frequencies. It's not really mathematically, it's not really, yeah, it's not really correct. So we have some speculations in the discussion on this article. And I will come to this article back with my last article I will present. And here you see that the prediction of the correct solution does not so much depend on the presentation format. So here we also did regressions with the help of Sven Hilbert. And so the calculation format is a best predictor. Though, of course, it's really interesting because the people really have already given the good information, the natural frequencies, but half of them, they think, no, it's not allowed, it's not correct maybe, or they just don't see that the solution is already given, and they calculate probabilities from the given natural frequencies, and then they are not able to solve the task. Okay, and finally, I will report from a German article. And in this article, we do some theoretical considerations on natural frequencies, because there are tons of articles on empirical studies on natural frequencies. But however, from a didactical point of view, there are a lot of dark spots. So for instance, there's no study about the existence in the world, or as I learned yesterday, in the wild, everyday language media. So we do not know why they are sometimes avoided in textbooks. So maybe one explanation could be that they are not defined as rigorously as probabilities, for instance. And what is also missing, so there are some definitions as expected frequencies, but these definitions only apply to a small part of the natural frequencies in the world. And something about Grundvorstellung and primary intuitions, it's a very important concept in the education of mathematics, in mathematik didactic. And then also what is missing, it's a plan to implement it in the spiral curriculum. That means that you already teach it for very young students and then you can pick it up again the next year and what you can do in every year. So systematically to implement natural frequencies in the curriculum. So the different kinds of natural frequencies that exist. And here I will give you a short overview. So if you look for natural frequencies in the wild, you can see in newspapers, so articles like this, 2 out of 5 single parents receive Hartz IV. That's a kind of social contribution by government in Germany. You can see down in fast 9 von 10 Fällen in almost 9 out of 10 cases. So natural frequencies are used approximately in fast 9, in almost 9 of 10 cases. So you can find this very often. And you also see other representations of uncertainty, of probability, of proportion in etwa jeder 5th, in every 5th German family. So you see it's in the wild and it's in the world, but you see it right below, that's also in the Welt, it's a German newspaper. Okay, so sometimes you have a kind of orgy of these representations, and so we did a systematic review of newspapers, and we basically found these 5 different representations. Of course, percent, Walter Krämer always is saying that it's the most used substantive probably in German newspapers. In school, for proportions and for probability, we also teach decimal fractions, 0.25, or fractions numerical as a number. We also figured out that very often you can find fractions as a word, you can find natural frequencies, you can find the representation every 4th, and chances you do not find very often. Here I can give you the numbers. Of course, Walter Krämer's Beaumont is correct, so percentage is the most frequent representation, at least of proportions and probability. As you can see, natural frequencies are the 2nd most, despite very conservative research. What do I mean with conservative research? So I mean, sometimes you can read, or very often you can read in newspapers, statements like, there was a tour with a bus, 40 people, and they went to this and this city, and blah, blah, blah. And on the way back, there was an accident, and 7 of the persons in the bus died. So you have absolute frequencies, 40 in the beginning, 7 at the end, and you have also the word out of, but they are not directly in the definition of a natural frequency. They are not 7 out of 40, so next to each other in the right order, but they are distributed. And so here it would be a reading strategy to find the natural frequencies. If you also count these cases, you have much, much more natural frequencies. So these are really conservative, real natural frequencies. So an interesting aspect which is not acknowledged so far is, regardless of the facilitating effect in school, we claim to make students fit for world, for reading newspapers, to be a competent citizen, but we don't tell them the representations they can find, the numerical representations of uncertainty, and so they should be implemented anyway, so even without facilitating effects. What is also very interesting, we teach students that there are basically 3 representations, but decimal fractions and fractions numerically, you cannot find at all in newspapers. Of course, decimal fractions for 0.2 liter or 0.2 kilometer, but these are not proportions. So these are specific amounts of a, that's not a proportion or a probability. And also you do not find a probability of 0.1. If you say the probability of rain is 0.1, then everybody would think 0.1%, because it's simply not available, the probability between 0 and 1, what we tell students, but we don't tell them, okay, in school, these are the three versions of relative frequencies, proportions, and probability, the three representations, but we don't tell them, if you go out to, the world, you will not find fractions. And of course, there is a journalistic convention not to use fractions numerically in newspapers. It's very interesting, so we didn't know it before. Okay. And finally, Patrick Weber did here great work, because some people think it's not mathematically correct, and because the probabilities, they are embedded in a probability space, so he embedded natural frequencies in a natural frequency space and showed that you can, as rigorously as with probabilities, you can construct the frequency space, you can do everything what you can with probabilities, so these also should not be problems to work with natural frequencies. And what we also did is really to define it, and unfortunately we tried to push the definition, it's only in connection with a Bayesian case, but we could not go through it, so we have to decide really to call all expressions of the kind A out of B natural frequencies, then the mathematicians will maybe accept it as a sound definition, or we want to stay with a with a so far definition, but it's very problematic, complicated. Laura was in the review process involved, and what is interesting is you have the world of data, you have the world of probability, and what you find in research is a probability world. You see that conditional probabilities, they are represented by natural frequencies. You can imagine an imaginary sample of 10,000 women, and then you can apply it, and then they are defined as expected frequencies. But in the literature, however, so we only find real frequencies, so real instances of 7 out of 20 people. Here in the room, 7 out of 17 people are male. So this you can find, and cancelled frequencies, if you say, for instance, every 4 out of 10. So you can find this, but we did not find, at least not in our samples, expected, so you have to make it a little bit wider, the world, to be accepted from mathematicians. So finally, the last slide, I will prove that 1/5 is the same like 5. In mathematic didactic education of mathematics, we know the operator concept of calculating with fractions. That means that 5/5 von, that is of 5, of something, of anything, you can calculate it by multiplying 1/5 of an apple, or 1/5 of the number 7, you have to multiply both. So 5/5 times 5, and that obviously is 1 times 5, and this obviously is 5. So if you have a fraction, 5/5 of 5, so you have to multiply, you have all of the 5, all parts. You have 5/5 of the 5, so you have everything, you have 5. And on the other hand, you have the natural frequency approach. 1 out of 5 is 1/5. And when you agree that 5/5 is the same like 1, then you have here, you can put all together, and then you have here 1/5 is the same as 5. So just as my slide here shows, the fraction is the same like the number. So this so far from me, and yeah, I hope for your questions. I close here. Yeah, I don't know whether I am the moderator or...
Yes, what happened?
Everything okay.
Everything is okay. You have a question?
So you
for
have
people
to come
in
here.
You have to come here because now the mic is or is this. And the camera is this.
Okay, good.
Yes.
So, yeah. People on Zoom, can you hear me? Okay, good. So, thank you, Stefan, for this presentation from Regensburg. You said at the end you hope for questions. I do not know whether you still would like to use the word hope if you hear what I now say. But I do not want to start with a nasty thing, but with something nice.
Thanks. So,
I found this very fascinating, and I'm very glad to see what you guys do in Regensburg. You and people on Zoom haven't heard this because the microphone was not working yet. He introduced Gerd and me as the grandfathers of this research with Stefan and Christoph Wasner as our children, and now we learned that we also have grandchildren. And in fact, there are these movies where the figure learns, oh, I have a child I don't know before, and this is always very funny in the movie, and yeah, some déjà vu here. Okay, so I'm very glad to see all this, and this is very rich, and also that this enters school, and we are all very excited about this. So, but now to the nasty part, and I think some of you know this, I have the reputation that I can be sharp and nasty, and I want to do it now also.
So and we all love it.
We all love it.
You just wait. can you go to, oh, I think I can do this, to slide 32. Yes, no. I have what I see. No, 32 was wrong. Give me. So, this occasionally drives me crazy when I see this in article that someone uses the term natural frequency and then gives an example, 1 out of 4. And then everyone says, okay, good, now I know what a frequency, what a natural frequency is, it is something out of something. I would say this is not wrong, but it's not particularly useful to explain what the concept is. And it's exactly for this reason also misleading. So if you have only one variable, whether you say 1 out of 4 or 25, to me it does not make such a big difference. Of course you could say, yeah, there is a difference, but I think this is negligible compared to the notion you need to understand in order to know what natural frequencies are. So we introduced the term natural frequencies in the context of a Bayesian reasoning task and Bayesian inference task, and here we have two variables, two dichotomous variables, a dichotomous criterion, the famous mammography, you have it, breast cancer, yes, no, dichotomous Q, and this leads to the 2x2 tables, Hans-Jörg had them yesterday, and then you have colon margins, you have row margins. And each of these four cells in the matrix, A, B, C, D, plus the four margins of, and then comes the total, let's say 1,000, are natural frequencies. And you can also relate them now to each other. If you have an A divided by A plus B, then you normalize. And if you present normalized information, then people have a hard time in the Bayesian inference task. But out of four per se is not a sufficient explanation of what a natural frequency is. And now I want to show you something where I was like shocked. And this is not the nasty part. Hmm? So natural frequencies in the wild. Do you say that these are natural frequencies?
Not me. Mathematicians, if you want to take serious by them, then you have to say it.
Okay, so then, this is exactly you guys who say that this is a natural frequency. I'm not addressing
you.
No, I'm happy that mathematicians.
Not me.
So I'm happy
Laura.
To. Okay. Laura, do you say that this is a natural that these are natural frequencies?
There are people who like simplicity.
I don't care about some people. Do you say that these are natural frequencies?
Could be.
Could be. No, I tell you why these are not natural frequencies.
When you take 5 von 5 allein at 7, you can assume that these are randomly taken in the population.
Yeah.
So of all possible 2 allein at 7.
Okay, good. It's the best estimate for something for a proportion in a big population. But then it breaks further down. So we have a Lineart Zehnde and we have Hartz 4. So we have two Qs. It's a binary representation, or it's a bivariate frequency distribution. But here we have normalization, guys, right? So in etwa jeder fünften deutschen Familie, so in 1 out of 5, and that means in 20 out of 100. And if I now want to continue in the spirit of natural frequency, I would say in 20 out of 100. So how much out of these 20? And if I continue that way, then I would stick in this natural frequency paradigm. Once I do no longer say 1 out of how many out of 20, but about 40%. That means 40 out of 100. Then I have no longer natural frequencies. So the each of them may look like a frequency, but the combination of these numbers that we see on this slide is not a natural frequency. These are not natural frequencies. In order to understand whether something is a natural frequency, you have to see how these frequencies work together. And you cannot just add 3 examples, one after the other, and say these are natural frequencies. And I was shocked that I've heard that someone believes that this is a natural frequency. So this person hasn't understood the concept. And then here is another example where, yes, here. This is also something where I want to make a comment on natural frequencies. So natural frequencies result from natural sampling. So if you go out and take a random sample, then you can construct these 2x2 tables. I claim that this one here did not result from natural sampling. What we have looks like a natural frequency because we do not have normalization, but it runs through. But I think this is not a frequency tree that results from sampling, but it's a frequency that is constructed, and it is constructed from probabilities. The probability of getting a positive mammogram if you have breast cancer, and the probability of having a positive mammogram if you, the positive sonogram if you have breast cancer. So these are two conditional probabilities, and then what has been done here, the assumption has been made that these two probabilities are independent. And based on this assumption, you can of course construct a tree that looks like a natural frequency tree, that is a natural frequency, but it doesn't come from sampling, but it comes from probabilities coupled with assumptions. So I just want to be very clear and very precise here.
Just one objection. This topic is very, very interesting, and all the things you have to say will be very, very important in our discussion that we have done on topics.
Okay.
Because it really takes discussion. I would like to discuss with you very seriously. There are other people who also have opinions.
Good.
The only thing I think is that we gather opinions in
okay,
the chat,
good.
And then we talk.
So people on Zoom, Laura just said that this is very interesting, but we need to discuss it, and this is not a point here to discuss things, and that was my misunderstanding. And therefore I hand over to someone who does not want to discuss something, or...
Can I just make one remark?
I
think I just...
present, and I just want
yeah,
to
yeah. Okay.
Okay, so, hello again, can you hear me? So, Ulrich, so thanks a lot. So first of all, I realized that you did not read the article which I sent you, because everything what you told us is literally explained. And do you know why I know all these things what you say? Do you have an idea why I know all of this? Because we wrote an article explaining it in just the way you explained it. And do you know why I also know all what you say? Because I did it in my dissertation, exactly like you say. However, one sentence. I tried for 10 years, because Gerd always says, bring natural frequencies into schools, not only as 2 absolute numbers. And I tried it for 10 years. Sometimes they implemented it as 2 absolute frequencies, and then I fight it for it, and I can send you about 80 pages of discussions with mathematicians and reviewers if you want to have the concept natural frequencies. That's unfortunately the only way, and the reason why I tell this that is a natural frequency is simply because I learned, not because I forgot what I wrote for 20 years. But read the article first, and then maybe we can discuss in it. Of course, then will be very fruitful.
Okay, I have a last comment. You and I wrote a book together, remember?
No, I remember.
Yes, you remember. And there we discussed a lot, and as you remember, Spiegelhalter, whom you respect and I respect, and Gigerenzer respects, is the authority. So Spiegelhalter has gone through all this, through all the things.
Repeatedly.
Yeah, repeatedly. Okay. So I want to say a final word, I hope, yes, which is that when we were writing the book, Ulrich, we went through all these discussions and we also read what Spiegelhalter has to say, whom you respect. So he said that there are moments when doing math in school, etc., where you cannot tell the whole story. And using this term natural frequencies that he uses also sporadically is a good way. That there is a deep story behind and that the article in Cognition, for instance, has to be taken seriously. What are natural frequencies and what are not natural frequencies? And we know that story. But the abuse of language that we commit when using them for that case of the Alleinerziehende Mütter is allowed. Okay? So I can show you that.
I would say the Alleinerziehende Mütter are not natural.
Good. The Alleinerziehende Mütter verlassen wir jetzt. We have time that we talk about all these things in a good discussion.
You can just put it up. Thank you.
Excuse me, one second. I have to change the PC. Just a second. Excuse me.
Hello everybody, I just jumped in and I want to say, this is Julian from Lausanne.
Hi Julian. You've turned completely French.
How that?
Welcome, Julian.
Thanks.
I was just saying that the discussion about what's a natural frequency and what's a simple frequency is, I sent in the chat, you find proofs for our forthcoming paper on figure 2. It's explained very clearly. And natural frequencies are like conditional probabilities. You need always two. Yeah? And simple frequencies are like simple probabilities, it's just one variable. So yes, yes.
She actually has breast cancer.
Because the base rate increased or because the test?
I don't know really. It's the numbers. I don't know if 2% and 80% are correct, but the positive predictive value now is 14%.
But I think because the sensitivity increased and the false alarm rate decreased.
Okay.
That's a different story.
It also depends on the age group. You need to say that.
It depends on the age group, of course. That's a number for women who participate in screening in an age group from 50 to 69. The whole age group, okay. Breast cancer and a positive or a negative test result. And we take a look on which elementary probabilities we have in this kind of situation. Of course, we have four marginal probabilities, and you can see that here. And we have, again, four joint probabilities, as we had heard yesterday from Hans Jörg. We have a woman with breast cancer and a positive test result, and so on. And as we all know, we have eight conditional probabilities. You can look at all women with a positive test result and ask how many of them actually have breast cancer and so on. So we have the first four conditional probabilities, and of course we have the corresponding inverted conditional probabilities. You can see it here. And so we have in sum about 16 probabilities in situations with two binary events, and for all these elementary 16 probabilities, you can you have school book tasks and you implement them in school. Okay, and now we take a look at a 2x2 table with probabilities, and we take a look which kinds of probabilities are implemented in this visualization. Of course, the four marginal probabilities, as we have heard yesterday, and the four joint probabilities. But there is no place where I can write down the conditional probabilities. Of course, I can try it, but this is not very helpful for students, I think. And you see, we are searching for a visualization where I can display all 16 probabilities. And now we have a 2x2 table, which is better suited for joint probabilities. And we have other visualizations which are better suited for conditional probabilities. And why would it be advantageous to have a visualization that enables displaying all 16 different probabilities? I think there are several reasons for that. There are several advantages if I have such a visualization. And I'll show you one. One reason is that the visualization can be completed directly without any additional calculation. Just one example, we try to solve a typical probability task with joint probabilities with the help of a 2x2 table with probabilities. This is from a Bavarian school book, And the given information are marginal probability and two joint probabilities. And you have to calculate also a joint probability, then just put the numbers in that 2x2 table, and I'm ready. I just have to know null 0.4 minus null 0.25 is null 0.15, and I'm ready now. So if I try to solve a problem concerning joint probabilities, that's very easy with the help of a 2x2 table with probabilities. I don't have to do any additional calculations. But what happens now if I try to solve a task with conditional probabilities, typical Bayesian reasoning task? Here you can see a task about teacher Müller from a Bavarian school book. He has a 25 probability of a disruption in class 10A in one lesson. And in case of the disturbance of the blood pressure of the teacher increases with 80% probability. But however, sometimes teacher Müller has increased blood pressure, also the class is completely quiet. The probability for that is about 10%. And now we try to solve this task, and that's not so easy. Of course, I can put in the marginal probability, but the second probability is a conditional probability. And now I have to do additional calculations to get a joint probability out of the conditional probability. And then I can write down the joint probability in the 2x2 table. The third information we have is also a conditional probability. So I have to do a second additional calculation to get a joint probability from the conditional probability. Then I can write down 7.5%. I can complete the 2x2 table. And then I have to do a third additional calculation, because what I want to have is also a conditional probability. So you know what I'm saying, this kind of visualization is very well suited for tasks with joint probabilities, but not very well suited for tasks with conditional probabilities. Okay. Now we have another kind of visualization, the double tree. Here you can see a double tree with natural frequencies and also with probabilities. And we have Christoph Wassner here, who wrote his whole dissertation about the double trees. And there's a lot of research about it from Lauro and also from Rolf Bieler. And in this kind of visualization, we have one very big advantage. We have, we can display both information formats simultaneously. I can present the absolute frequencies in the nodes of the tree, and I can present the probabilities on the branches of the tree if I want to. And therefore, I can build a bridge between cognitive psychology and mathematics education, because of course we all know that natural frequencies are very much better to understand, but in school I also have to teach probability, and now I can build a bridge and I can use the natural frequencies to understand the probabilities. And that's an advantage, that I can present both information formats simultaneously. That's not so easy in the 2x2 table. Of course, I can try to display one below the other, but you remind there are still the 8 conditional probabilities missing. And in the double tree, I have the 4 marginal probabilities, and now I also have the 8 joint probabilities. But here I have no branches for the joint probabilities. I have the 8 conditional and the 4 marginals, but the branches here are missing. Of course, I can, but I don't think, Ulrich, that this is very nicely designed and very helpful for students, because there are several questions. Should I draw these branches here or below the tree or both? And it might be confusing. You have a lot of branches in this visualization. Okay. We really like the double tree, the double tree with the natural frequencies in the nodes. And we did a lot of teacher training and workshops with students and also with school students. But in the last years, we had identified 3 disadvantages of the double tree. The biggest one I have already told you is that there are missing branches for the joint probabilities. Then we have also received feedback that it might be confusing, that we have 2 branches which overlap, and I have write down the percentage 86% on a very bad place, because now it is not easy to see where does the 86% belong to the lower branch or to the upper branch. And we have a new study results which shows that students confuse these probabilities. Of course, you all know 14% plus 86% are 100%, so it must belong to the lower branch. But the question here is, at which place students write down this information, because this is a very lovely place for this kind of information, and maybe the students are confused afterwards if they write it down like here. I can simply solve this problem if I write down this information below the trees, and I can clearly see it must belong to the lower branch. Okay, but now I try to find a visualization where I have no overlapping branches. And there could be a third disadvantage. I have sometimes heard from researchers also that we have two nodes with the same information. And I have heard from one student who said, these are two different kinds of subsamples. I have 10,000 women who are ill or healthy, and I have another subsample from 10,000 women which participates in routine screening. So that might be confusing. I don't think that number two and three are the real big problems. I wanted to solve the problem number one, and therefore I want to show you a video now with a new visualization, and please enjoy the video. I hope it works. And I hope you can hear the sound in Zoom. Another version with Eye of the Tiger, I can show it next year. Okay, what I want to show you now is a suggestion on how to solve typical probability problems like the mammography problem in school with the help of the frequency net. And it was already published in Stochastik in der Schule. And the first step just would be to draw the empty structure of the frequency net. And in the lower part of the nodes, we will enter the labels in the next step, and the upper part of the nodes we will enter the absolute frequencies. The next step is just labeling the structure. So we have women with breast cancer, without breast cancer, and with a positive or a negative test result. And that's one advantage compared to tree diagrams, because in tree diagrams it is really important which kind of information is in the first level and which kind of information is in the second level. And here with double trees or with a frequency net, it doesn't matter, because at the end you have a completely filled visualization where all statistical information can be read off. And then you can also label the end nodes, the corner nodes. The next step is to enter the given information. And if the information in the problem is given in the format of probabilities, which is usually the case in German school books, then the next step would be to enter the probabilities on the corresponding branches. But don't worry, of course, the most important step is the next step, and there we use the natural frequency concept. But now we enter the typical probabilities, and the prevalence is mostly given as the first information, which is 2% in this task, and we have the sensitivity, which is 80%, and at the third information, we have the false positive rate, which is 10%. Step number four is the most important step. Now I consider a concrete sample, for example, 10,000 women. And then in the next step, I translate all probabilities in the format of natural frequencies. And I can say 2% means that on average from 10,000 women, 200 have breast cancer. And 80% means from the women with breast cancer, from the 200 women with breast cancer, on average 160 receive a positive test result. And the 10% means that from the 9,800 women without breast cancer, on average 980 will receive a positive test result. And now you can use the additive structure within the frequency net, and you can say if you have 160 ill women with a positive test result and you have 980 healthy women with a positive test result, these are in sum 1,140 women with a positive test result. And of course you can also fill the notes below with the help of the additive structure of this frequency net. And now in the next step you can read off any information you are interested in. You can read off any joint probability, and in the mammography problem, you're interested in the probability of having breast cancer after a positive test result. And here you can see from 1,140 women with a positive test result, 80 actually have breast cancer. So the correct solution is about 14%. Okay, now I want to show you the first empirical results on the efficiency of the frequency net. And the study is already published in Frontiers in Psychology. Okay. And now I want to show you the design of the study. Our participants were 249 university students from Regensburg, and we had a 4x2x2 design. It was a paper and pencil test, and we had four different kinds of visualizations. We had tasks without any visualization, with a 2x2 table, a double tree, or a net diagram. And of course, we had probability versions and natural frequency versions, and we had two contexts. Context was not a factor of interest, but we have the mammography problem and the economics problem. And we asked two questions on each task. And today we only take a look on the first question, which was a typical Bayesian reasoning question. What is the probability that a woman who participates in routine screening and receives a positive test result has breast cancer? And if the task was provided with probabilities, then the question was also presented in probabilities. And if the task was provided in the format of natural frequencies, then we have a natural frequency question, as you can see here. Okay, these were the tested versions. So in the probability versions, the visualizations only contained the probabilities, which are typical for this kind of visualization. So in 2x2 table, we have the joint probabilities, but no conditional probabilities, and in the double tree we have the conditional probabilities but no joint probabilities. And in the frequency versions we had no probabilities but only the absolute frequencies in the nodes of the double tree and in the nodes of the frequency net and in the cells of the 2x2 table. Here you can see the results of our study, the percentages of correct inferences for the probability versions. Here you can see the text version, almost nobody is able to solve the task, but if you present a visualization, it is getting better. But remember, in the double tree and in the net diagram, this, the correct percentage is already within the visualization. It's just the task to find the correct percentage. And therefore, 34% is not really much. In the 2x2 table, I have to do a calculation, of course. Now I want to show you the results for the frequency versions. It is much better if you provide the information on frequency, as we all know. And if you provide an additional visualization that contains natural frequency, then it is much better. The 2x2 table was the only visualization the students know before, because they are always drawing it in school. And they have never seen a double tree with absolute frequencies in the nodes before. And we didn't explain this kind of visualization, and they have never seen a net diagram before. So we were surprised that it was so easy to read the correct information from the frequency net. Okay, We did not only take a look on the percentages of correct inferences, we also analyzed the typical errors that occur in the tasks, and there are a lot of studies that have done it before, Gigerenzer Hoflage, Su Gigerenzer, Diaz Bazzanero, and so on, and you have seen, we have also an article with Georg Bruckmeier, where we analyzed the typical errors. And one typical error is the joint occurrence, where you confuse the probability of B under T plus with the joint probability of B and T plus. And another typical error is called the Fisherian, which means to confuse the positive predictive value with the sensitivity, with the probability of T plus under B. And now I show you the results. Looks complicated. Above you can see the probability versions, and below you can see the natural frequency versions. And then we have in the first column the text-only version, in the second column the 2x2 table, and then the double tree and the net diagram. And the white areas that you can see show the correct inferences, the percentages of correct inferences, and you see a lot of green. Green is the joint occurrence error. And you can see that the joint occurrence error often occurs in the 2x2 table with probabilities. And the joint occurrence error also often occurs in the net diagram with probabilities. And you can see if you translate the information from probabilities in natural frequencies, then this joint occurrence error is getting smaller and smaller. And we also have a lot of blue here, which is a Fisherian error. And we have this error, especially in the text versions, without visualization. If we would have tested the tree diagram, not the double tree, we would also see more Fisherian, I think. Okay. There would be so much more to say about the frequency net. There are several rules that apply in the frequency net, distinguished by branch language and node language. Maybe we can discuss them later. Okay, of course we have some limitations of our study because we did not answer the question so far, are students able to create net diagrams on their own? And that's of course the most important question now, and we plan to investigate that. And we have results from a pilot study, of course. One very big limitation is also that tree diagrams are more flexible. If I want to visualize situations with more cues or with more Q values, because if you imagine you have women which are ill or healthy and you have some mammography test result and then a sonography test result, then the net diagram is getting three-dimensional and it is not any really cute anymore. And so tree diagrams are many more flexible here. Okay. Then be careful, our message is not to only use the net diagram now and to never use 2x2 tables anymore and tree diagrams and double trees. Of course, the change between different kind of visualization is very fruitful. But we just wanted to show you this new kind of visualization. But what the message should be, always use, if you use a visualization, then use natural frequency visualizations. If you use a visualization with, which contain numerical information. We have further results because in the study I showed you now, Binder Klaus Wiesner 2020, we also asked for a question for joint probabilities after the question for conditional probabilities. So we have results on this and also error analysis on this. We now have a further study on the effect of the frequency net with school students, and we compared the frequency net with the tree diagram in the study. And further ideas and projects are, we have to do a training study, which is the most important question now. And I think one further point is very important, because the error analysis are very interesting. And I think this should be knowledge for each teacher. If I stand before the blackboard and I present to my school students a 2x2 table with probabilities, then I have to know what do my students think right now. What might be the typical errors that occur now? So this is a very important knowledge for teacher, I think. And I would go one step further and say, It would be very interesting to know for students too, in the sense of Fritz Oser, who is speaking about negatives Wissen. So I think we have to build negative knowledge with students, and therefore we have to do a little bit more research about the typical errors that occur dependent on the typical visualizations which are used in school, and dependent on the information format. So do certain visualizations prevent special errors, or do certain visualizations provoke specific errors? That are a really important questions, I think. So now I want to thank you very much for your attention, and I'm very... Okay, you can.
Thanks a lot for a great presentation, and I very much like the frequency net. I see one issue with it, and I'm wondering whether there's ideas of solving that. So if you combine the frequency net idea with what I presented yesterday, so I had this one slide with this cube, and then there were three 2x2 matrices which result from looking at this cube from one of the dimensions, or collapsing it across one dimension. And then you could further project each matrix into two trees. So if I'm correct, and correct me if it's not correct, then what the frequency net does is essentially it solves, it gives me all the information on one of the matrices. But it doesn't, so, or in other words, so it takes the two trees that you can get from that one matrix and combines them in a better fashion, so in a more transparent fashion, I think, than the double tree did. But it doesn't, so, but it still has the problem, or it's not a problem, but it still has the feature that it's one of the dimensions is implicit. So it, and that the reason for that is essentially it really is, I think, in the core of it, it's a three-dimensional problem, or you're doing a two-dimensional presentation of it. So essentially, I think you're losing one of the dimensions is lost, or it becomes implicit, and I think in the frequency net the accuracy is still kind of in the diagonal essentially. Mm-hmm. So is that a correct description? And then are there ways of avoiding it somehow? Or is it, so to me it seems it's an advantage over the double tree essentially, but it's still, it still has that issue.
I think you're completely right. It is two-dimensional. But I have to use it as a tool for solving problems with school students. And the school books are two-dimensional, so this might be an advantage in this case too. But you're completely right, and I think we have to talk about this issue later.
So